What's up, nerds?
Nerd!
What up, nerds? Goz Master here with another Magic the Gathering puzzle quest. Today's quest, Jaya, Fire Negotiator. I'm going to be going over this brand new Planeswalker that's available for IRL cash. Today's video is sponsored by Oktagon. Thank you so much, Oktagon, for giving me early access to this mono red walker. I'm going to do my best to spotlight her strengths and weaknesses. And for you, the viewer, I'm going to be making sure that I'm 100% transparent and honest about what I actually think about her and whether or not you should pick her up for IRL money or for gold whenever you're watching this video. Maybe you're doing a review. I'm getting a lot of views on new walkers when they're available for gold. And I don't address you, the gold buyers. So for the gold buyers, salute. I always enjoy your support, the people, my fellow nerds. Comment, like, subscribe, all the good stuff. It's necessary, helps the channel a lot, like dramatically. I have no idea how much it helps. And we're on a quest to get it to 1,000 subs, so definitely make sure you're clicking on that subscribe button. That said, let's get into Jaya, Fiery Negotiator. She's a Fiery Negotiator. What do you get when you pick up the bundle? All right, so she's available right now in the vault for IRL cash, $24.99 US American D dollars. You get 40 gold crystals, you get 20,000 runes, excuse me. You get 120 pink crystals, you get 3 red booster packs, and then you get Jaya herself. The packs percentages, they give you everything available that is red or a chance at everything that's red. 100% for commons, 99, etc. 19% for mythics and a 1% chance for a masterpiece. Yay, they're adding masterpiece accessibility to these. Thank you guys, appreciate that so much. So let's talk about the Planeswalker herself. Okay, so first things first, Jaya, Fire Negotiator, 95 life total. Mono walkers with 95 life. That's a down for me. It's got to be over 110 for mono walkers, and especially on their loyalty abilities, depending on how strong and how fast they are. Jaya is pretty fast, so 95 is pretty understandable. Where you really want to watch this is I would not choose anyone with less than 120 life for objectives that say have X or more life, unless you have an OP collection and it doesn't matter, you just win. But if you have a beginner to a mid-level, mid-tier collection, that life total can matter, so be aware of that. Max level, you get impulsive, you have 3 loyalty abilities. Her first is at 7, impulsive deal. Pick one of the first 3 spell cards from your library, fetch that card, it gains outcast. So very similar to DTK, Dress to Kill, Down to Kill, Chandra. It gains 6 mana, though, however, and then you convert 4 gems to red. That last sentence is what matters. You pick the spell, that spell gains 6 mana, and then convert 4 gems to red because of her mana bonus. We'll get to her mana bonus in a second. 12 loyalty for diplomatic artillery. Pick one of the first 4 spell cards from your graveyard. Exile that card. If you can't, exile the first spell card from your library. Copy the last spell card from your exile. That copy gains full mana. So the good thing is you get to pick from your graveyard. So if the card you want to have duplicated and getting full mana, case in point like M5 or something like that, you can actually choose it from your yard. You just got to make sure it's in your yard. She, especially with the builds I'm going to spotlight here, she exiles a lot of her cards. So just be mindful of that, but we'll talk more about that here in just a minute. All right, so this is a very good functional spell. Full mana, you know I love full mana. Fiery Fusillade, is that like Gatorade for fire? I don't know, but it's 20 loyalty and you get to create 6 red monk tokens. They're little 1/1 weenies with prowess. So you do the thing, you get the bonuses. Creatures you control gain haste until end of turn. Deal X damage to target opposing creature. X is equal to 5 plus the greatest power amongst creatures you control. So again, haste as a loyalty ability is always goofy because if it's pre-swap. So if I'm casting a creature, that creature does not get haste. Again, Oktagon, I would really implore you that if you're going to do something for a loyalty ability that is haste, give every creature on the board haste and every creature in hand haste until end of turn, please. That makes a big difference. Anyways, I digress. Moving on. Deal X damage to target opposing creature. X is equal to 5 plus the greatest power among creatures you control. What's good about this is that if you're behind or if there's a creature on the board you need to get rid of and that creature is susceptible to damage, again, thanks, Remy Slayer. You're keeping everybody from, taking damage, so it's appreciated. So overall, all 3 of her abilities are solid. Her first, I spam the tar out of. That conversion is important because there's not a lot of really solid red conversion in the meta right now as of DMU. If you're watching this after another set is released, hopefully in the future you have better conversion than we do for red right now because there's really not a lot. I'll spotlight what we do have for you as we go along. The second ability is solid. If you're behind, you need to go get something out of the yard that you get to pick. And that third ability is pretty solid as well because you get to do a lot of damage. The only criticism I have about the third is for that much loyalty, I would rather we're able to shoot face to like any opposing target, not just opposing target creature, because then that becomes 20, 30 damage we could do as a nice coup de grace or grâce de crew to our opponent and be able to wind up win. So that's the only criticism I have about it. I really don't, like, I've tried saving up for the third. I find the first and the second more useful than the third, because that first one for 7 loyalty to get that much advantage is really solid, really, really solid. All right, let's talk about the big elephant, the red elephant in the room. Mana bonuses. Everything is flat except for red. You get +9. I never, ever want to see anybody buying Koth ever again. Never buy Koth. Never buy Koth. Koth is now obsolete. So all you guys talking about, well, Koth has this function and Koth has that function, and I really like +9 to my red mana bonuses. Jaya is better. Period, point blank, Koth need not be purchased any further. You old dogs that come at me every single time with Koth is good and I like Koth and blah, blah, blah. Look, I respect. Hashtag absolutely respect the OGs. I 100% do. Stop it. Koth is a waste. And you'll see why when we get into deck building here in just a second. But with that said, my initial review of Jaya, just my at a glance before I've even played with her, but I've already have, review of her, she's solid. She's really, really, really good. My first impressions are I think she might be, if not the best, one of the best for sure in mono red. The only other walker that might be able to compete with her is Chandra DTK, down to kill, dressed to kill. So let's put it to the test. Let me go show you a couple of different gameplays and deck builds and see what goes on. Go Cardinals. All right, let's get in my Pauper build. Halana and Alena, partners. Najal, the Stormrunner, is something new out of the new set. I think this is a rare power card and it's an uncommon, which is pretty powerful. Okay, let's spend a minute talking about red conversion right now. So, Crystal Grotto, 7 mana, support card land. When the support enters the board, pick one of the first 2 cards from your library, then put the other on the bottom of your library. When the support gem is matched, gain 6 mana. Now, this is not specific red conversion, but this is a solid way to kind of filter the top of your deck, clean it up, and then in addition to that, gain some mana when you match this out, and it only has 2 shields, so it can be destroyed. As far as red-specific conversion, you've got Wooded Ridgeline, 8 mana, land Mountain Forest. This support can't be reinforced at the beginning of your turn. Convert 2 gems to red or green. This is one of the new ones. It doesn't reinforce, so I can put multiples on the board. The best lands that I'm finding right now in standard for monocolor walkers, especially for red, is Roadside Reliquary. At the beginning of your turn, convert 2 gems to your planeswalker's colors. When this support is destroyed, draw a card. Then if you control an artifact card, that card gains 3 mana. Then if you control an enchantment card, that card gains 3 mana. So potentially, you have an enchantment and an artifact. It gains 6 mana for the card you draw once this is destroyed. The other one is Secluded Courtyard. At the beginning of your turn, convert 2 gems to your planeswalker's colors. If you have at least 3 different creatures that share a type in your library instead, convert 3 gems to your planeswalker's colors. You want to have 3 humans in your build, which I don't, which I would recommend. I think that would be a better play of it. So my creatures right now, human, Efreet, and then my third creature is Rocco, Cabaretti Caterer. What's up? I see here that you want some sandwiches. Rocco gotcha, right? My apologies to all of those folks that actually talk with an accent that way. Rocco's broken again. I'm going to be spotlighting. Spoiler alert. I'm going to show you how Rocco's broken and my final build, my mythic build. We have River Deer's Charm for a little control. Rob the Archives, best red card in standard right now. Sorry, spells, as far as mono red is concerned, it is an absolute beast for functionality within Pauper, I should say. And then Maestro's Charm. We're using double charms in here. Does the things, does the damage. Use both the charms. There's a screenshot for you. Click, click. And yeah, let's go ahead and use the deck and show what we've got. Let's see what we got here. Rocco right away. Let's do it. Let's actually get some mana conversion though. I want to show you some of the stuff this stuff does. All right, so red. I mean, it's not hard, folks. Just get all the red you can. We're going to loyalty drop in here. All right, cool. We've got some conversion happening ASAP. Oh, Kothi boy. Let's take a look at Kothi in comparison. So right away, better mana bonuses than Koth. Destroy 12 non-red gems. Okay, so you get some conversion, but you don't get to fetch a card. You don't do anything else. You don't give that card mana. I argue her first is better than that. Give your creatures +8, +0, trample and berserk until the end of your turn. Woohoo. 12 loyalty to get it done. And strength of the mountain, create a support on the board. Whenever any player matches red gems, all creatures gain +4, +4. All your creatures gain +4, +4. Whatever. Not necessary. Total ridiculousness. Not even close. Jaya by a mile. A Jaya mile. All right, let's see. No red matches. This is going to be a battle for red, so let's see where we can get more mana. We get better mana bonuses. We get better mana bonuses. All right, yeah, we're going to confirm that. What do we want? We want, let's take Alana. Actually, let's take Nigel. Nigel. All right, let's spotlight our first ability. Pick one of the first three cards from your library. Fetch that card. It gains Outcast. 6 mana. And what we want to do is we want to get a card that's going to get draw mana. Ooh, we like that one. We like those. We love those. If he had creatures on the board, we take Riveteers. If we have mid to late game, we take Rob the Archives because of the casualty and all the other stuff that goes along with it. But we have both of them, so we're going to go ahead and do that. Try to find a red match wherever you can. Boom. Always take the red. Always take the red. Except for when you can't. Now, this guy... Oh, I forgot to talk about her passive ability. Her passive ability, she always gets a monk for the first red spell you cast per turn. Totally spaced that. Sorry, that was the reason I was on the other section. But I'm going to go ahead and sacrifice the monk because it's the weakest power. It will get bigger and stronger as we go. But it's all right. It's all right because... and I would advise probably limiting your deck builds to 2 creatures. This one has 3, but my other builds only have 2, and I'll show you here in a second. Now, all the cards I just drew that had Outcast got exiled from hand. I'm totally okay with that. It's fine. I didn't have them in the first place. People always look at those and say, well, I lost all kinds of different benefits from not having it. You didn't have them in the first place. They were extra. If you could cast them, you would, but you can't, so you don't. So it's no big deal. Let it go. Get over it. You're fine. You're going to be fine. We're all going to be fine. All right, so Helana's ability is that they give their power to others permanently at the beginning of each. This is such a mythic powered card, and it's a common. It's so good. Such a good card. We're going to give it to Synergy here. You would want to have a creature that it gets stuff and benefits based on its power. So I'll spotlight something in the next build for you. But that said, power. All right, so Crystal Grotto, let's get some more beast out. Actually, let's spotlight the secondary ability. What do we have in our yard, actually? We only have 2 spells in our yard. We have Riveter's Charm. We can spotlight the second one. Let's do it. So we're doing the second one. Boom, Riveter's Charm. We get a copy of it. We get 2 copies of it? We do get 2 copies of it. Look at that, like a looter and a riot. What is that? That is our, that one. Let's not match that one. Keep that alive. Confirm. We're actually gonna keep Maestro's Charm. Boom, we got it. We get to draw those 2 cards. Get some mana. Yes, we do. And then we confirm, and we'll take, let's take Rob the Archives because it keeps our hand draw going. Destroys their creature because I guess we have enough black gems on the board. I don't know. We win. Let's go, what do we want to replace? Let's replace that one. See the prowess in action. Confirm. We're going to take more secluded courtyard. You get the bigger. We get to draw a bunch of stuff. He gets bigger. We cast some spells. He gets bigger. Let's go ahead and make him... Actually, this one's running right now, so let's give it some speed and some power. Go for 9. Oh, he had Outcast, so he disappeared. Unfortunate. Also, Outcast works really well with Blitz creatures, because when they die, you get all the Blitz benefits. So, something to go from there. All right, we are going to have a lot of red mana conversion. We're going to get into our third, maybe? Let's see. Look at this. Look at this. I don't know what's happening. I have no clue. We're just winning. Let's see. Rob the Archives. We'll go here first. And we're going to toss that one because it's got Outcast, just in case it does work. It's weird. Outcast works sometimes and it doesn't as intended. So sometimes it'll exile your stuff. Other times it won't. It's really, really weird. I prefer it not to cause any issues for what I'm doing. All right. Let's do none of those. No. Nope. That one's going to be important. Here's our second. Get a bunch of those. Let's go ham. Bye-bye. All right, family just got back, so I have to tone it down a bit while they're actually doing their work out there. All right, so let's see what we've got going on here. Look, he's actually giving me a run for my money, but I'm also playing a pauper build, so I don't want to hear any complaints about, guys, you were actually getting your butt kicked by a cuff deck. Yeah, come on. I'm also running all lands, so you can see the conversion. Where he's running a more synergized deck. But no excuses. I'm still going to win. Yeah, I guess let's go here. Got a chance at a black match. Nope. Boom. And boom. So next turn, maybe? Let's see. Should have used my first ability. All right, won't make that mistake this time. Let's just get it done. Oh, we had a five match. It's a problem with conversion. We always wind up converting out of our five matches typically. Let's take you. All right, and let's go there. Boom, boom, game. Sure, let's go Rocco. Let's get a big boy. Let's go here. He gets bigger. No, not now. Yes. Boom, game. There you go. So again, not a build focused on the synergy of the winning, but as much as the just demonstrating, just with her abilities alone, her loyalty abilities alone, pretty much won the game. I never even ramped into her third because it wasn't necessary. I really don't use it a lot. All right, but that's that. Let me show you my peasant build. All right, so here's my peasant build. Some of the carryovers, Riveteer's Charm, Rob the Art, Riveteer's Charm and Maestro's Charm. Solid, helps deal with most of the things you're gonna run into in the board. Good for red removal, they're solid cards, absolutely. Rob the Archive, same thing. Good combination, good synergies. If we're running red, you know we're running Rem, Carlo, Stalwart, Slayer. I'm flexing a bit. This is the alt. This is the full art version of the card. This is something you can get from Fibblefip. I don't think this art's actually very great, but I just love the card so much I had to have it twice to master it. I love this card. It's such a great card. Probably one of the best creatures in Standard right now for mid-tier collections. Absolutely one of my favorites, but he's a boss. In addition to that, I'm also doing a weird flex in Zyatora's Envoy. Another card available for Fibblefip. I think this art is hot. I love the Art Deco stuff. Probably some of my favorite art that's available on the full art cards. I'm on a process of collecting all of the alt art cards. I know, a waste of resources. However, and because I already have them all, I just love these cards so much and the design of them. I'm happy to own them twice and master them twice. They're a lot of fun, but he is an absolute beast in this deck. Angel Fire Ignition, you need a little bit of life gain, and this is a great card for two reasons. It synergizes really well with Slayer because it gives him Vigilance, Lifelink, and Haste till end of turn, which doesn't matter, and Trample till end of turn, but it's that Vigilance that matters. He can be killed. So your creatures get Vigilance, and so anything, they build a wall of death that your opponent typically can't overcome. Now we're talking about spells at the rare level. Some of the best spells you can have is Alchemist's Gambit, Double Strike. You can take an extra swap. Absolutely a beast card. Late game, you can use it to buff their creatures, especially if they're like 1/1 weenie tokens, who cares? But you get another swap, another chance to swap before you go. Double casting your spells, pretty powerful stuff. Rite of Flame, best mana conversion right now for red. It is a PMA. It is a chase card. You need to go after it. Play the Colors of Magic event when it comes around again. Try to get another pass at being able to get these cards. This is absolutely a card you want to get. It's powerful. As far as land conversion is concerned, this is a rare Sokinzun Crucible of Defiance, 10 mana, legendary, and you can kind of cycle the card. At the beginning of your turn, convert two gems to red. The best red conversion right now, or the best mono-colored conversion, I should say, for red or green is Renin 6. Yes, it's a Vanguard. Yes, you're going to have to go spend some pinks to try to get it. It's absolutely worth chasing. This, Tamiyo's Vanguard, and Teferi's Vanguard. Go get all three of those. You need them. For all other decks that can't use Tamiyo or Teferi, this is the third strongest Vanguard, in my opinion. Convert X gems to your Planeswalker's colors. X is the number of non-creature cards in your graveyard. So here's the other thing I wanted to point out about if I edit this. Let me answer the real question. So why is Jaya so much better than Koth? Because even if not only her mana gain is better, I think her first ability is way stronger than his first ability. And as a result, maybe his third stronger than hers. Okay, I'll give you that. Maybe. But I got six creatures. I got seven spells I can add, and I can have up to six supports in this, where Koth only gets, what, two supports? Ridiculous. Absolutely ridiculous. Let's go. Come on, it's not even funny. This Walker is so much better than Koth. Don't get Koth. Stop wasting your effort, energy on Koth. Come on. All right. How does this deck play? Let me show you, man. All right, so here we go. Let's go get Remy out right away. Red match sounds good to me. Give him a five match. Okay, but I'm doing damage. Come on, Karn of the Silver Reflections. Didn't take the five match. I always question when he doesn't do that. I always expect Karn to take the most, like even if they don't take the five match, they always get the most mana from a swap. So when he does something that just gives three, that makes no sense to me. Okay, hack time. When you cast this card, you may destroy target creature you control with power equal to or greater than this card's casualty. If you pick a creature that has prevent damage as Rem does, as the rest of the creatures do, either one of these. I can choose either one of these, select it with casualty, and it does not kill the creature because it has prevent damage. This is a bug. This is known. Some people get very upset that that's not the way it's intended, so you shouldn't play it that way. Then the devs should fix it. No offense, Oktagon, but if you were putting it in the game for us to take advantage of, we're going to take advantage of it. If you came out and asked everybody to not do it whilst you're fixing it, I would honor that. I would respect that and say, okay, cool, that's what we're going to do. That's what we're going to do. That's not the case. It is in the game. It's as played. It's as functions. So that's the way it's being played. So as of right now, the rule is that doesn't work against prevent damage creatures. So I get to cheat out all the stuff I want because of it. Thank you. I will take it all day long. I'm actually going to toss this because I don't want to cast that and then take away my Remy. Let's see. So deal with it. I've had some recent comments in a respectful way, disagreeing of opinions, not a negative thing. You know who you are. About certain things and the way games should be played. My attitude is this is their business, right? Oktagon, I'm talking to you with all the respect and admiration I can definitely pour into that. I hope you guys know that I absolutely adore this game and I play it a lot. I've invested a ton of money into this game, resources, not to mention time, effort, energy, I mean, blood, sweat, tears. I've done a ton of stuff, both for the game's production and content, as well as playing the game and just, you know, enjoying it for my own personal desires. With that said, we're all adults and this is a business. You guys need to, if there's something you don't want us to do, fix the code. We tolerate and put up with a lot of bugs that are in the game and we suffer game losses and stuff and freezes and all kinds of different things that happen, right? You don't intend for those to happen. We have to deal with them, right? Same applies vice versa. If there are advantages we get from the game that we can take advantage of that give us a chance to win better against the AI, we're going to take it. This isn't player versus player real time. This is player versus machine, and we're trying to outrank each other by getting the most points, you know, with a cap here. I'm going to go get as many points as I possibly can, and I advise that you do the same if you're watching this and take full advantage of it. Once they fix it, then it's fixed. It's no big deal, right? Until they do, maybe they never fix it, and if they never fix it, then it was, I look at it retcon as always as intended. So why wouldn't I take full advantage of it the entire time? Silly not to. That ends Goz's rant. In the meantime, let's go win. All right, so we have a lot of shenanigans going on here that aren't just, I don't know why, how many of those? And Shuffler is not fine, folks. I think we all realize that Shuffler is not fine. Look how many of the same card I have in hand right now. Kind of ridiculous. Case in point, Shuffler's not fine about the bugs and the things we have to deal with. I'm going to give them a double because I want an extra swap. I'm going to use my first ability here. We got double strike, doing the thing for prowess. Oh, and just in case you want to know what prowess is, this ability triggers whenever you cast a non-creature card. That's prowess. So supports or spells, give it the bonuses. I'm going to take this one. Convert. Oh, look at that. It turned into a 5 swap. I love it. I like it. I want some more of it. All right, let's demonstrate the Remy deal. We're going to make him Vigilant, Lifelink, Haste, Trample, Big Dog. We have all the things. We're casting all the things. We're going to go ahead and shoot him with Rob the Archives and get another full mana into the card that we had. We're not going to do that one next because we got an extra swap anyways. And now that that's full mana, we will let that ride. Don't want to cast another Remy with Outcast. Because I don't want to risk losing him, just in case. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. Or maybe you know why it works sometimes and why it doesn't others. I don't know. Let me know in the comments below if that's the case. Why are you not going to destroy this guy? All right, there he is. I don't know why it wasn't triggered. See how it was disabled there for a second? No idea why. Let's get this out. We haven't demonstrated Ren and Six yet. So let's get Rennie, Sixy. I don't know what's happening. I just know I'm full life, and he's down to 59 life, and we're going to win because that's what we do. That's what heroes do, is we win. All right, let's get this out. I want to demonstrate this. It's just devastating. But you'll notice because of how much Outcast and how much other stuff is going on, we don't have a lot of stuff in our yard. We've cast a bunch of stuff, but we don't have a lot of yard stuff. Let's go here, I suppose. Boom. Not enough. Got the red conversion from that, but we're setting up red for them. Is Karn going to take our red? Karn typically takes your color matches. That's really pretty brilliant, because that's an effective gameplay strategy. If you're playing Karn, take your opponent's colors away from them. So it's good to see that the AI does something that gives us a challenge. Let's draw another card with our first ability. Let's take Riveteers, because it gives us more draw, fills our hand up. Let's go here. Boom. Doing some damage, filling our hand with mana. Solid stuff. Good stuff. All right. And more. I don't know what's happening. Half the time I build stuff and I test stuff and it works, and I don't know, have any clue as to why it's working or how. I just do the thing, and it just makes me money. It's awesome. And by money, I mean gameplay money, not IRL money. Not yet, but if you like and subscribe and we get to 1,000 subs, I'd be able to monetize the channel just on viewership alone. That would help support the channel dramatically. So hit and like and subscribe. Thank you. Thank you. All right. I don't know what's happening right now. I'm just holding on for the ride. Let's go here. Boom. Let's lose Blitz. I didn't even demonstrate this creature yet. And he has Outcast. Let's see if he exiles. Like, he should exile at the end of turn. Let's see if he does that. And maybe what it is a creature with Outcast exiles if it's not a reinforcement. I don't know. Shall we put it to the test? Let's put it to the test right now. Anything for science, right? First off, let me demonstrate this card. Renin 6, first ability, convert X gems to your Planeswalker's colors. Explosions. We like those. We love those. Great ability. One of my favorite ways to monetize the red conversion. We're going to go, I don't know why I'm saying monetize a lot right now. It's kind of my catchword for the second. And our hand is completely full. Let's see if we can ramp into our third here. All right, so we're going to give him haste. We're going to give him lifelink. We're going to give him double strike. It's not going to matter. We're going to win. look at our boy right here. 44. Sure, let's go do some more stuff. Let's take one of those. Why not? Let's go. That's game. Boom, boom, boom. And then Zyatori would give me double strike. It'd give me two cards with full mana because everything in my deck costs less than what his power is times three. Mass chaos. Very, very good. That's the way the deck should work together. Solid build. But that's not my mythic build. I got to show you something that's broken. It's really broken. Let's go. All right, my friends. So I spotlighted this in a previous video, and Oktagon fixed it. I am spotlighting another way to break this, and I'm anticipating Oktagon is going to fix this. Or maybe not. Maybe this is the one way that you can get what you want. All right, so Rocco Cabaretti Caterer. Back in the day, if you guys don't know, young crunks, if you aren't aware of this, there was a minute when Rocco first came out where he could target himself, and as a result, he was broken in that he could go fetch himself, give himself mana. See, what would happen is his stored mana would not reset each time you cast him. So, in other words, if I cast him the first time for 13, and then I fetch another Rocco, he would come to the in hand, and he would have that 13, he would have the 7 from the 13 as the stored mana. 13 mana would apply towards getting this next card. So he'd have 6 stored mana. But when I cast him and he hit the board, his 6 stored mana added to the 13 stored mana that was there. So it was 19 stored mana. And then he would go and fetch another Rocco. And this time it would be 19 minus 7. So he'd have 12 plus the 19 we'd have. So he'd be over 20. So essentially created this endless loop where I could just pick my own creature over and over and over and over and over again, make a beastie creature as big as I wanted, and then I could swing for dome. But what would have happened had they fixed that, Rocco would have fetched himself 20 mana for 7. It would have gotten himself, and it would have been diminishing returns. It would have been 7. It would have been 20 mana for stored, minus the 7, left 13. It would go fetch another creature, another Rocco, for 13 minus 7. That would leave a 6. Then it couldn't get it. So it could only be able to reinforce himself twice. That's the way the card should work. It's not the way the card works. Instead of fixing that, Oktagon, I see you. What you guys wound up doing is you just said, oh, he just can't target himself. Problem solved. Easy. Not quite, my friends, because we have this new card called Meeting of the Five. 20 mana, 20 loyal mana, 5 colors. Fetch first 3 different cards with exactly 3 colors from your library. Those cards gain full mana. Jaleva, Nefalius Scorch, 13 mana, stored mana of 6. When this creature enters the battlefield, move the top X cards from each player's library into your exile. X is the amount of mana that you use to cast this card. That's what's important. She costs 13. He costs 7. So what's the new card, Goz? Those are old cards. We couldn't break it before. Yeah, but let me show you Jota. Jota Unifier. Now, counterpoint. You cannot get this card unless you have an exclusive content pack unopened from the last battle from the Ages. So I have this card early. A lot of people have this card early because the Battle from the Ages event gives us pink for gold almost at an even exchange. In fact, I think we come out ahead. It's a great event to go grind out pinks.
Hey, phrasing!
With that said, you also stack a bunch of exclusive content packs. Well, anytime they add new cards to it, those cards are available for us to grab from the exclusive packs. Is this the way it's designed by Oktagon? Is this the way it's supposed to work? I don't know. Is this the way it is working? Yes. Are you going to take full advantages of those? While the shuffler's broken, yes, we are. So let me introduce you to Jota the Unifier. And case in point, right now, you can get this card the next Battle from the Ages. Play the event and get this card. This is the best card in the set as far as I can tell so far. It might be the only chase card in the set. There's a couple that are really good, really fun. This guy's a breaker. Let me show you. Jota the Unifier, 15 mana, legendary, 5 color. You know we love 5 color. Human Wizard. And it's a support. At the beginning of the combat on your turn, legendary creatures you control get plus X until the beginning of your next turn. Legendary creatures you control get plus X for each of their reinforcements until the beginning of your next turn. So it's a two-step function. X is the number of legendary creatures you control, including the reinforcements. That's solid. That's good. That's great. Powerful all on its own. That isn't it. That's not what breaks it. When you cast a legendary card, move the first legendary creature or support with a lesser mana value than the card you cast from your library to play. So, here's the way the combo works. Jaleva hits the board. From Jota's on the board, Jaleva hits the board, she fetches a Rocko. Rocko is full power with 20. You have to cast him with 20 of these things in advance because it never goes away. Then you go fetch another Jaleva. She hits the board. It allows you to get another Rocko. He has full mana. I will demonstrate. I made a mistake in the build, though. There's another broken combo here, which is Unlicensed Hearse. Somebody in my Discord recommended this build. They said, take out Soul Herder and use Unlicensed Hearse. I said, oh, okay, I was spectacle. But then I wound up trying it. Great call, man. I will demonstrate this. This basically gives your creature power based on how many cards are in any creature in your opponent's exile. Rite of Flame for conversion, Ren of Six for conversion, Angel of Fire Ignition for life gain, Invoke Calamity for casting more spells, Riveteer's Charm, yada, yada, yada. I did not make a mistake in here. I wound up taking out... you are a legendary creature, so I actually did make a mistake. So you got to make sure, for this combo to go off, that she has no other legendary creatures to fetch, legendary items to fetch, that are this, that can get in the way of getting Rocko. So we've got to go get another spell of some type. Twinferno. We'll add that. That's from the new set. We'll say go. Is this an artifact? It is an artifact. I'm going to actually take Unlicensed Hearst out. Oh, Alchemist Gambit. Duh. Why aren't we taking that? That's an easy peasy card to take. All right, so this is the modified build, so that should not interrupt the combo. All right, cool. Let me show you some chaos. Organized chaos. All right, so first things first, let's go ahead and do Riveteers. Let's actually power this all up and get those going. And again, red matches. And guys, I thought we were spotlighting Jaya here. Yeah, we are. But I want you to see Rocko at his finest. Let's get the combo going right now, baby, shall we? We're just missing Jota. Not now. Not going to cast that now because we want him full power first. All right. We lost it because it had Outcast. Okay, that's fine. That's fine, mine. Let's go here. Boom. Only 6. We're going to wait. We're going to make sure he's full power before he's on the board. All right. Where is Jota? Let's take 2 of these bad boys. Actually, let's do Riveteer's Charm after. Oh, they got Scion of the Draco. Cool. Let's go here. They've got a masterpiece. Nope, not yet. Oh, you killed my monkey. It's all right. You die too. All right, there we go. Meeting of the 5. Just what the doctor ordered. All right, let's go ahead and do this impulse. Let's grab to Inferno. See what that puppy's like in action. Boom, boom. Let's go ahead and let's ditch Invoke Calamity. Let's actually ditch Riveteer's Charm as well. All right, let's go here. Is there any red matches I've got? There it is. Boom, right there. Here we go. Yes, we're going to do that. We want Jaleva. Now, the combo's not going to work this second because we need Jota. We need to go find some Jota. Jodeci. We can actually do Rocco. We can do it again. We can take Jaleva again. See? Stored mana. He only had seven, so he's grabbing two of her, though. We want to get as many cards in our exile as possible. If I had Hearse. I don't have Hearse, so we're not worried about it. Oh, another Rocco. Fine. Let's take more Jaleva. Full Jalevas. Right? Just that combo alone is ridiculous. I mean, it just works. M5, Rocco, and Jaleva. It's serious. And if you were just playing Hearse and you don't have Jota yet, Hearse is the alternative. Hearse will give you the strength. It'll give you the power. You'll have the touch. You'll have the power. You got the touch. All right, Twinfrano, cool. I'm looking for Jota. Where's my Jota? Shuffler's not fine, folks. How many I've been shuffling and going through and spotlighting all of these things and nothing. All right, let's take another Meeting of the Five. Meeting of the Five's pulling cards out of my deck. The odds of me pulling a Jota top deck are infinitely stronger down. There it is. Great. Finally. Goodness gravy. We're going to get rid of all this other stuff because we want to get this mana conversion. We want Jota to get on the board. Let's do Angel Fire Ignition. Let's gain some life, shall we? Oh, that didn't cause any cascades. That's fine. Let's get rid of that. Ah, man, I really needed that to get powered up. So much so that I think I'm going to hold on to these spells until Jota's on the board. So we're just going to go Wang. No cascades. I made the right call. Let's take another meeting. It's fine. Let's do it. All right, now we're going to demonstrate it. Let's see what we got. That's a big boy. Killed my Rocco. It's all right. Doesn't even matter. Oh, actually, it does matter. Rocco needed to be full power, but he will be when I do Meeting of the Five right now, so that's fine. Oh, we do want that. Let's do. Yeah, let's go there. Boom. Okay, no more moves. Cool. We can't give everything double strike. That's fine. Let's see, do we get Rocco? We'll say yes, but it's not going to do anything. Invoke Calamity hits my hand. All right, where's Rocco? There's Jaleva. She's coming in. Now, as a result of her doing this, I'm going to get a Rocco that hits the board. He's at zero. So I'm going to pick Jaleva. It's going to give me a zero-powered Jaleva. Rocco is cast from my hand with full power. I'm going to say yes. Now I'm going to take a Jaleva. She's going to have full power. You see, they're full mana. Same thing. I got Rocco to hit the board. I'm doing this. We've started the combo. It's official. Here we go. Now, a couple of things that happen here, okay? Rocco hits the board, full power, we get a Jaleva. We guess the Jaleva, full hand in hand. We cast the Jaleva. You'll notice the stick. Everything's sticking right now. She hits the board, and then we get a notification up here that says how much cards were exiled. We should get a notification. There it is, 251 right now, right? At some point, I don't know how many, I think it's four or five times of doing this, this stops happening. This trigger here stops happening. And we put, it's already stopped. See this? It's happening a lot faster. There's no delay now. So we are no longer adding cards to our grave or to our exile. And I don't know why that is. And I think that might have something to do with the fact that there's only so many cards in your hand before it redistributes. I think there's like 40 or some cards like that. I'm not sure what it is. There's an explanation. You guys that are smarter than me that have been playing the game and understand the mechanics of the development side of stuff, let me know in the comments below why and how that's happening. I have no clue. But that is happening where I think it's that we're out of cards in our decks until we stop the turn, and then it adds more cards to our deck. Because we have unlimited decks, but they're not calculated forever. They are done in like 40 to 60 card chunks. And once we blow through those, or maybe it's 90 or 100, so I don't know how many are there. There's a lot. Once we blow through those, once they're all in my exile, like they are right now, there's nothing left in our libraries, and I think that's why this is triggering this way. So I can do this into infinite. There's nothing stopping me from doing this right now. I can just keep continuing to confirm and go from here, and it's just nonstop shenanigans, powerhouse, here we go, right? I'm gonna stop it after my first timer, so give it a second. So we hit our timer, our loop timer, and now we're going. Now Jota should give us all the power. It did not. So this is broken if you exceed those timers. So I'm going to do it again this next turn. And it's either because I hit yes to stopping the shenanigans, or I don't know why. So I'm going to do it one time this time, and you're going to see the full benefits of Jota, which is on the board, so we should get all of the benefits from it. So let's go ahead and we're going to take our double swap here. We're going to go boom. Right? We're going to get double strike. And we're going to see the shenanigans. Hits the board. Exiles cards, right? We should see the exiles here. We're going to take another one. That's a graveyard. There's only 10 cards in my yard, but 289 out of 38 cards. I swear I think that's what it is. We're going to do it one more time, and then we're going to stop it, okay? Because I just want you to see 326. But we have 20 and 19. We're going to say not now. Not now. We have two extra swaps. I'm going to lock everything down because I don't want to cast anything. And let's go. Boom and boom. Now look at their powers. Jota should work this time. Wang. Eight, was that 1835 power? Yeah. Yeah, that's fun. That has nothing to do with Jaya. That works with anybody that can run those three cards together. Rocco, which is three colors, both of them, and then you could basically run them in any of those three colored card decks that you can have. But it's a lot of fun. It's super powerful. I did not demonstrate the third ability. You get it. It's you get to kill a creature. You get a bunch of monk tokens. I think Nalthazar in his video spotlights the third. I don't think it's that powerful. I don't think it's necessary. I think you're going to be spamming the tar out of the first abilities. All right, let's review and recap. What do I think of Jaya? Final thoughts. Okay, Jaya, Fiery Negotiator. Is she worth the IRL? Yes, she very much is worth the $24.99 American USD dollars. If you got the cash and you can support the game, highly encourage that you do. She's absolutely an S-tier red mono walker. With cards and set right now, she is an S-tier walker with the cards that are available right now. And I say she's an S-tier as long as we're in this standard with these cards available. M5, Rocco, and Jaleva. As long as Jaleva's in game and she doesn't get nerfed, she's broken for any pretty much any build that you have. So you definitely want to go get her and make that happen. But guys, what if I don't have those cards? Is she still an S-tier walker? I think she is, yes. I think she's powerful enough on her own. As you saw me against Koth with a Pauper build, with Pauper cards that are available, there's several cards that are available. I wound up doing well with it. Now, that said, I will point out that if you're running a mono red walker, you absolutely need to go get Rite of Flame. Rite of Flame is absolutely one of the chase cards you should be targeting. Red PMA has very few cards that make the grade on usability, but Rite of Flame is absolutely one you should have. It makes a massive difference in mana and red conversion. If not, you saw some of the other reliquary and the other lands that work well, especially the one that targets and converts to three if you have three creatures of the same type in deck. I do recommend using only two creatures with her in deck because of the tokens you wind up creating and you're not swapping them out, or if you're afraid of disabilities, getting disabled by like Sleep of the Fishes and that kind of stuff, you might want to consider running a fourth creature or a third creature rather in deck so that you have four creatures total with the monks so you can swap them out and you're not ever beholden to disabilities in the game. That said, her first ability is absolute fire. Fetch a card, give it six mana, outcast, okay, downside, but you're casting a spell, and especially if that card draws other cards as we get more cards added to the meta with new sets that come out. That's only going to get stronger, and it converts four gems to red on the board, and your mana bonus is so high from those red mana bonus gains. Absolutely fire. Much better than Koth, in my opinion. Even if he's destroying all the non-red gems, that does not put you red gems on the board. It maybe does at the top, but it's not guaranteed. This does, and I think it's a lot more functional. The second one, with a full mana card from graveyard to hand and being able to cast that thing twice, really powerful. That's on par with Professor Onyx's secondary ability, and I actually think this one's better. I'm not sure what Onyx's second ability is cost-wise. And then the third one's a good finisher from removing creatures off the board if they can take damage. The only downside to it is I would love for it to be able to go face in addition to just creature. And also, it doesn't help you against PD, prevent damage. If you suffer from PD, call a doctor for more than 4 hours. So matches can last a lot longer if they do as a result of it. It's not something that you actually want to have happen. And her cost being at 20 loyalty for it is pretty expensive. The monks are actually really good. I like the monk cards a lot. They get super buffed. A lot of times with double strike, especially if you have Alchemist's Gambit and they have double strike, that's usually your finisher, and that's really where you want to go. But you're going to get those just by casting red cards organically through the rest of the match. So your third is kind of a win more thing. It's not necessarily a need to win, but it is handy when you need to come from behind.
Hey, phrasing!
And you actually wind up winning that way. So, and her mana bonuses. Dude, no negative bonuses, all nine to a red. I'm for that all day long. If you give me mono walkers this way, with plus nine to their main color and nothing to anything else, I would take that every day and twice on Sunday. That is so powerful. And then give me a good set of loyalty abilities, I'm all in. That's a lot of fun. That would make mono walkers a lot more fun to play. And as you know, I'm not a fan of mono walkers. I'm not. I really like Jaya Fire Negotiator. And the real question is she better than my number one red walker, which is Chandra Dressed to Kill? I'm going to say there about even keel. You can't go wrong with either of them, but early play, I've got to say, I think Jaya nudges her out slightly. I think that first ability for the mana conversion is that much better. I think it's just a smidge better because of that. I would spam the tar out of that first ability. Looking at Chandra, her first ability costs three more, or two more. She only has two more life. Her first ability of doing damage, or her standard, is good. She gets plus seven to red, plus three to the other color, so that's pretty comparable, but she gets minus two to the other ones. I don't care about the minus twos. All in all, though, I gotta say, Chandra is my favorite red walker up until now. I actually think Jaya is better than her. So if you're gonna pick up a mono red walker, if you're into mono reds, Jaya's gotta be my recommendation. I think she has so much synergy, she's got so much power, her loyalty abilities are strong. Every single one of them is functional and they can help you. And that plus nine to red mana gain, it's hot. It's really hot. And I never need to see Koth again. I never need to see Koth ever again. Jaya will take his place. I guarantee. With that said, what do you think of Jaya? Do you think you should pick her up? I absolutely do. If you don't pick her up now for cash, pick her up for gold at some point. She's a lot of fun to play. She's destructive and a lot of fun to run with. Will she help you win objectives? I think so. I mean, obviously my first priority is, does it win? There's a lot of events we play that are just win now. I'm always looking for fast walkers that can win an event right away. Training grounds and like Trial of the Plains and those types of things. I want to go win those as quickly as possible. I'm not trying to finesse them. Main events like coalition events or weekend events, I'm playing Dakin always. Dakin's the strongest there is. But as far as mono red walkers are concerned, she's absolutely, I think, my top tier red walker for now. I may amend later. I always reserve the right to amend later. But right now, I think she's tops in mono red. So that said, what are your thoughts? What do you think? Are you going to pick her up? Have you picked her up? What's your favorite build for her? Did I miss on something positive, something negative that I should have? Comment below. As always, I appreciate you. Could have been anywhere in the world. You should spend this ridiculous amount of time with me here ranting on about Jaya. I really think she's awesome. But as always, like, subscribe, comment, join us in the Discord, continue the conversation. I have photos in the Discord of her each level up. So her at level 16, 30, 52, I believe it is, and then 60. So you can see the different power ratings for her. So you can identify, you know, what capacity you can get her to. The good thing about mono walkers is you can rank them up to level 60 pretty quickly. And I think you should always have your walkers at level 60. It's fun. You get the best competition that way. And you also get to see their full powers, which is really what it's about. What are we doing? What are we doing? Let's fight full power. Come on, man. We're not trying to go Super Saiyan half. We're going Super Saiyan. Let's go. Until our next quest, my friends. Swords up.